Simon.
Thank you very much. Wow, I really pity the person who has to do some live coding after Josh Long. Sadly, it's me. But I'm going to talk to you about a number of tools and really going to be talking about how you can actually be more productive in your day job. We're going to do some Java-y, we're going to do some Spring. I'm not going to do too much Spring, really, because Josh has kind of done a fair amount of that, and it's pointless me going over the same stuff or a lot of similar kind of stuff. So we're going to be focusing mostly on the Forge cases. I'm going to start off with a story. Story's about a bunch of monkeys, a ladder, and a bunch of bananas. Who's heard of this story? You know if you've heard this story. I don't know if it exists. I kind of want it to, but we'll see. So there's five monkeys, and they're in a room. This is a scientific experiment. We're used to these kind of scientific experiments here, I guess. But this is maybe a little bit simpler. We're not going to be flying these monkeys around 27 kilometers at super speeds. But these monkeys see the bananas, and they naturally just want to go and grab those bananas. So one monkey goes up, tries to grab the bananas, and what happens? These happy, fluffy monkeys turn into these kind of little wet, very, very sad monkeys because they're sprayed with cold water. They're being punished for one monkey going up to this to the ladder to grab those bananas. So what do? Every single time a monkey tries to go up the ladder, what they end up doing is beating the shit out of that poor little monkey. And they're now in a state where they're policing themselves, because these monkeys have learned that when a monkey tries to go up to get the bananas, the others beat them up because they don't want to get sprayed. At this point, they get to a stage where none of the monkeys are actually going up to get the bananas. They see it, but they understand the self-imposed rule that they don't go up to get the bananas. Then they take one of these monkeys, these conditioned monkeys, out the group and replace it with another monkey, this kind of weird-looking, fluffier monkey. And this monkey sees the bananas, so he naturally tries to go and get the bananas. So what happens then? All the other monkeys go and beat the crap out of this poor monkey for just trying to get the bananas. And they slowly condition this monkey. He doesn't know why, because he hasn't been sprayed yet. They then replace every other monkey with a non-conditioned monkey till they have five non-conditioned monkeys. If we were to introduce another monkey into this group now, all the other monkeys would set upon this poor monkey and beat it up. Why do they do that? They don't know. Because none of these monkeys have been sprayed. Okay? They've got a self-imposed rule that they're following, that they don't know why, they don't understand the consequences, but they're still following this rule. And this is one of the things around productivity, which I think is very, very key. And when we join a new group or a new team or a new company, and we learn about what the tools, what the processes are in this company, people very often say, ask as many questions as you can. And the reason is because it's all too easy to get stuck in this rut where we do the same thing again and again without asking ourselves why. And without realizing it, we're one of these, you know, conditioned monkeys. Okay, don't be a conditioned monkey. Let's move on to something completely different from conditioned monkeys to me. This is me. I work for ZeroTurnaround. We are a company that create productive tools, tools that make developers better developers. I also created the virtualJUG. Who's heard of the virtualJUG? Few people. Good, reasonable number. The virtualJUG is a virtualJUG. It is a Java user group that is completely virtual. We don't really have meetups at all. We do things completely online. As a result, we get speakers like James Gosling, like Josh Block, like Arun Gupta, Mark Saizele. All the best speakers in the world come to speak at the virtualJUG. One other thing I should probably say about me, maybe this is just an admission. I used to work for IBM for 12 years on WebSphere Application Server. Hello, group. My name is Simon. I used to be a WebSphere developer. I'm sorry. Any WebSphere users here? Sounds like a drug case. Any users in the room? Just one person. What version of WebSphere are you on? Which version? 8.8.5.7.6? You're just trying to make yourself look better in front of the group now, aren't you? Okay, so I used to work from about version 4 up to about version 8, 8.5, and then I moved to ZeroTurnaround about 4 years ago. So what is productivity? Who knows what productivity is? Who thinks they know what productivity is? One person, two people, three people. Productivity is about making a turtle go faster by sticking a rocket on it. We're talking about basically making things go faster that either shouldn't go fast or take time. We can do that in a number of ways. One of the ways is removing non-essential tasks. Tasks that we don't need to do, like the monkeys, right? Self-imposed rules. How can we remove things that we're doing today that we genuinely don't need to do? Another way, optimizing tasks. When we know we have to do tasks, how can we speed those tasks up? Back in 2005, I used to have a 3-character smiley. I increased my productivity 33% in 2015 by being able to do the 2-character smiley. Another way is retaining important tasks, making sure that when you go forward, you don't actually remove too much to try and speed up your process, because don't lose sight of your goal. Speed is just a measure of how fast you reach your goal. We don't want to, you know, move from WebSphere to Tomcat necessarily if it's not providing us everything we need. Maybe consider a Tomy or something which provides us everything we need while being productive. I love this picture. Are you too busy to improve? When we think about productive tools, tools that help us and generate code for us, write things we don't need to write ourselves, it's really, really great, but it takes time to learn. It takes time to adopt. And we have to make sure we spend time in our jobs trying to understand how we can be better in our jobs. So it's not good enough to say, I haven't got time to do this. I need to just do work, okay? Who agrees? Quite a few people. Do you want to see a dog doing some chemistry? Yeah? Let's do some of that instead. Right. So, let's first of all talk about JBoss Forge. Who's used Forge in the past? A couple of people. Anyone heard of Forge? A few more people. So Forge, JBoss Forge, is... Can you see that? Is that type font okay at the back? You can see that? Cool. So what is Forge? Forge is let's write Forge and see what happens. You can brew install Forge. Forge is just an environment that allows you to rapidly generate code from scratch. And you can also use this for new projects as well as existing projects. And what it allows you to do is scaffold code, which is typically a pain in the ass to write. So, for example, Java EE has a whole bunch of artifacts, a whole bunch of boilerplate that you need to write in order to actually get anywhere. Forge will, in a way, scaffold and create all of this for us just by writing some kind of scripts. It's an environment, it's a shell kind of environment, so if I hit tab, we get some you know, nice commands. Here you can see some similar commands to kind of Unix commands, so cat, cd, clear, grep, all these kind of things, but also a whole bunch of Forge-like commands. So I can use tab completion, so let's create a new project. So if I was to say project new, if I hit tab after that, we then get the information about what we need to provide. So these are all the options that I can provide to my project new. The green option named there, this is my required attribute, so I have to give it a name. Let's call it VoxCern. Just to be really interesting and original. If I hit tab again, named has obviously been used already in this command now, so I don't need to add that. But what else can I have? I could have a build system, maybe. What build systems do you guys use? Maven? CBNZ? SBT? The simple build tool? The simple build tool? Yeah? The worst named build tool in the world? The most ironically named build tool? Any ant users? Any makefile users? Hardcore users? Gradle? Quite a few Gradle. Let me hit build system. In Forge, you can actually use whatever build systems you want to, so long as you actually include the add-on. So if I was to type, If I was to type build system there and hit tab, I get Maven automatically because that's the only add-on that's available to me. If I was to come over here and go to add-ons, Forge, oh, there it is. Here you can actually have community-contributed add-ons that you can install into Forge. So if I wanted to type Gradle, for example, in here, we have our Gradle plugin. So all you need to do is come here, grab this this add-on command, throw that into your Forge console, and you'll install the Gradle build system in here. But we're going to use Maven. I don't need to type this because it's going to be my default. Anything else I can type in here? I can actually have an application type. So here, in fact, what I've also done is I've installed the Fabric 8 plugin. As a result, I can create a Spring Boot application if I wanted to, as you saw Josh doing. But just here, all I'm going to do is just kind of create a regular war kind of type. Now you'll see that I'm actually in the VoxCern project. So if I do a print working directory, you can see we've created this VoxCern project. If I do an ls, you'll see I've got my Maven POM. I can cat that Maven POM, and you'll see it's actually very, very straightforward. Nothing really there, no dependencies, because all we've got is an empty project. What I'm going to do is I'm going to import this straight directly into Eclipse. How many Eclipse users here? Well, actually, a reasonable number. Any IntelliJ? NetBeans? There's always one NetBeans person. Oh, three NetBeans people. Wow. Any hardcore Vim, Vi? Well, there we go. This is the place for it. So I'm gonna import my Maven project in here. Okay. Deselect all. What did I call it? Where is this? Oh, is it in my home folder? So I used to, as an IBMer, I used to use Rational Application Developer. Any RAD users here? No, one RAD user. The rest are probably just still waiting for it to start up, I guess, and didn't quite make it. As an ex-RAD user, hang on, let's stop this. Let's go out of this, and let's do this again. I thought I was in the, yeah, you're right. So let's do this again. As a RAD user, I'm perfectly happy with my Eclipse. It runs very, very fast for me because of what I'm used to. Okay, so it wants to scan everything. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to come out of this. Let's just go into my downloads directory, and I'm going to run the same command. And I'm going to come here, and I'm going to go into my downloads directory, and deselect all. And there's my VoxCern. I'm going to import this. And in VoxCern, you'll see my POM script. You'll see I've got everything that a good Maven build should have, but actually no code. We just have our package and so forth. So let's create some code. Now when I hit tab, I have a whole bunch more kind of operands I can use. And the one that we're going to use, we're going to create some JPA. I'm going to create a new JPA entity. So I type JPA new entity. And the options that I have are named, obviously. So what shall I call my JPA entity? I'm really bored of books. I'm really bored of people, persons, libraries. What can we call it here? Say again?
Protons.
There we go. And what can I have? Here I can actually choose my JPA provider. So you can choose exactly what you want to deploy it against. Hibernate is the default here, but you can pretty much just choose what you want. You can also choose the JPA version if you choose, 2.0 or 2.1, based on your preference. But that'll pretty much do, I think. Let's just create that JPA entity. If I was to go back into my clips, refresh my package, you'll see that now we have our protons.java. It's pretty simple. We've got an entity here. We've got a field, which is a long ID, we have a private int version, we have our setters and our getters, we have a toString, equals, and a hash code. So it fills in a fair amount for you, but what we can also do from within here, let's also show you, if I was to refresh here, we also get our persistence XML. And within our persistence XML, you can see we have all the usual Hibernate stuff, but so far I haven't touched a single line of code, haven't even needed to touch any XML. So what we're going to do now is we're going to go into the JPA new field. And we're going to create a field. What does a proton have? Quarks. Like that. We can also choose some types. Let's have a type long. We can make it, let's not make it transit, but we can do whatever we want. We can actually map that to a column name if we want, called quarks. Now we have our new field created. I can come back into the protons. We see that we have our new private long quarks. We have mapping that to a column name. And we also have our getters and setters at the bottom. Also, you'll notice that since I created the entity, we're now in the protons.java scope. So if I was to just type an ls there, rather than get a kind of directory structure, we actually see the schema of the class. So we see the fields, we see the methods, and so forth. If I wanted to add a constraint to that, I can say constraint add. And here I can just choose what I want to do. If I just hit return, because I don't give enough of the information, it puts me into a it puts me into an interactive mode. So I can say, well, let's have a constraint on quarks. Let's say it has a max. Add a constraint, yes, groups don't need to. Value, let's say we're allowing 50 quarks. Is that reasonable? I have no idea. Let's say yes. Message, not allowed more than 50. How did I spell quarks? Let me see if I'm spelling it right. How do I spell quarks? Oh, okay, I did spell it right. Quarks. Payload don't need. Okay, so now if I go back to here, you'll see that we have on our here on our quarks, we now have a max constraint value of 50 plus a message. If I go and have a look now, we also have a validation XML, so we're using bean validation. So as you create and you construct and you generate code through JBoss Forge, you're automatically getting all the artifacts, the XML needed to bundle it together in your environment. From here, let's do some REST. Everyone loves REST. From here, what I'm going to do is I'm going to generate my REST endpoints from my entities. I need to point to my targets. So I'm going to say my targets are going to be the protons entity. And I think that's pretty much all I need to do, so I'll create that. Now, if I come back here, you'll notice that we're going to have a REST endpoint here on my protons endpoint. You can see exactly where we're going to be showing that. So now we've done this, let's actually build it. To build it, because you have these add-ons where you can choose if you want Maven, Gradle, whatever you want to do, you don't actually call the command directly. You can if you wanted to. You could call run C, which is going to run a native command on your local environment. But what we're going to do here is we're just going to call build. And build is effectively just going to run the build environment underneath. Here we have build success, so now we have our war, which is in our target directory. So now let's go and deploy this. To deploy it, we can either do it in two ways. We could be boring and we can go outside of Forge and deploy it manually to our app server, or we can do it from within Forge. So to do it from within Forge, we're going to use something called AS setup. Now, AS Setup is another add-on in which you can control application servers, whether you want to use Wildfly or whatever app server you have. It doesn't support all app servers, but you can actually create plugins if you wanted to use your own. So within AS Setup, what we're going to do is we're going to choose our server. Our server is going to be Wildfly. We're going to choose, what else can we choose? We're going to choose our version of Wildfly. Our version that we're using today is 10.1.0.final. We're going to choose the install directory. So that Forge knows exactly where to go. This is going to be in users, SJ Maple. It's in downloads because I'm really bad at putting stuff in reasonable places. And it's in Wildfly, and we're using Wildfly 10. What else do I need to do? Let's have a look. I think that's pretty much it. If you want at this point, you can add JVM args, you can change your Java home or whatever you want to do. But that should be enough for now for us. So that's now creating the AS setup. All that really does is just create a file called .forge settings at the base directory of this project, and that's just going to provide us with all this information. From here, we can do an AS start, and this is going to just start our server. So you can see we're actually connected to it and we have a Wildfly server up. From here now, once this is started, all I need to do is I haven't finished, because what we've got with our application is we've got an application with no front. So what we can do now at this point is we can scaffold it. So we're going to call scaffold generate. And this is going to provide us with some nice front end so that we can actually test. And we're going to scaffold generate with a provider. And our provider could be whatever we want to do. In this case, we've got, I think, AngularJS and Faces. Let's just stick with Faces because we seem to be going the Java route here. And I also need to add my targets. So I add targets in here. And my target needs to be protons. I think that's pretty much everything we need to do. So I hit that. We'll see if I come back to my environment here and refresh, you'll see we have our new view with all of our kind of JSF going to exist in there. So now let's build this one more time so that we have everything built into our war. And then that's just simply AS deploy. There we go. And this is now going to deploy this straight across to our application server, which is running. And we are up. So now if I come here and I just go to my local host, and what did we call it? We called it Protons. Did we call it Protons? Oh no, VoxCern. Sorry, the name was VoxCern. Protons was our entity. Okay, we go to Protons and we have this nice little environment running up for us, which is surrounding our business logic. We have our entity here. We can add some quarks. So let's create a new number of quarks. Let's say this one has 10. Let's say this one has 20. And just to show you something where if we were to go over 50, hit save. No, not allowed more than 50 quarks, which was the message, the constraint that we got. So we're using JSF to render this. We're using bean validation, as we saw. We're using JPA. And we've got an application that I'm testing on Wildfly that I haven't written a single line of code for. And I haven't written any XML. The world is great. Also, I showed you we did some REST. If I was to go into my REST interface here, and what was the... What was the endpoint? Was it just Protons? Yes, it was Protons. So if I go REST Protons, we can also see in JSON, the entities that we have there. I can also, if I wanted to, go /1, and you can view an ID, an individual instance of that entity. So life is good. What else can we do? I'm going to jump back out of this. What I'm going to do is I'm going to shut down the server. And what I want to do is I want to show you another tool which will allow me to actually have an insight into what's going on into my runtime. So I'm going to go back to my settings. Here we go. In my setup, and I'm going to add a JVM argument. And this JVM argument is going to be a Java agent. And this Java agent is going to be found in the users, sjmaple. It's going to be xrebel slash xrebel. .jar. And what this is going to do, xrebel.jar, xrebel is a performance monitoring tool, and it allows us, and I'm just going to restart this server, and it allows us to grab an insight into what's happening beneath our application, what's happening in terms of both application profiling, what's happening in terms of our interaction with any third parties, databases, web service requests, and so forth. But the interesting thing about xrebel is that it does it during the developer time. So because it's a Java agent, it can bytecode manipulate class loaders and all kinds of things, data sources, whatever you want under the covers. And as a result, it can grab really fine data and push it straight back to the user, because what xrebel does is it injects the widget, the toolbar, directly into the response object of the application. So I'm also going to deploy my application again. And then when I come back to my runtime, when this is finished, Come on, Forge. Come on, Wildflow. There we go. Now we've got this Forge. We can also see xrebel here in the background. And the nice thing about xrebel is when I click through, and this is going to be quite interesting, and I create a new item, you'll notice straight away that there's actually a problem within JBoss, and there's an exception found here, which is quite interesting. Now, I haven't actually sent this back to the JBoss yet, but I will. An exception, this is based a hidden exception. Exception that's created, maybe thrown in court and nothing done with, but an exception that's in the code, which is kind of just potentially bloating system out. But I'm going to now create a quarks, create my entity. In the background, what you'll see is a number of things. First of all, we have application profiling, so you can see exactly where we're spending our time, either cumulatively here, where you can see the amount of time in the forward branch, or the absolute amount of time being spent percentage-wise, relative, in that instance of that method. And you can see it you can see the bottlenecks simply through knowing that if it's over 1%, you get a little blue box. If it's over 10%, you get a yellow box. Over 30 or 50% maybe, you get a red box. So you can see your bottlenecks fairly straightforward. The other thing you can do is you can actually see what is being driven through the data sources. So in this case, we have some Hibernate, and you can actually see what is being driven through. You can see here we have a persist call, which is just a statement. We have a select here. Once we've actually pushed to our backend database, we're going to do that get to actually view everything in the database. So we can see under the covers exactly what's happening. There's some other stuff there as well, but I'm not going to go into that now. What I want to show you, I'm going to AS undeploy. The next thing I want to show you is how we're going to use Arquillian. Who's heard of or used Arquillian before? Just a few people. Okay, so Arquillian is a testing tool, and a testing tool that allows you to, in a very unit test style way, mechanism, allows you to actually push your code to a container and run your tests like they were unit tests. So unit tests are great. We're able to write them, we're able to quickly test small pieces of code. But if we want to actually push that into a container so we're not doing as much mocking, not doing as much scaffolding round, then we need to use something like Arquillian. You can run Arquillian in a couple of ways, either a managed way, whereby Arquillian will completely control your container. It'll start your container, deploy, test, undeploy, and bring your container down. Or you can run Arquillian in a remote way whereby you control the container and Arquillian will just deploy and test to it. So here, I've already installed the Arquillian add-on into Forge. So the first thing I'm going to do is an Arquillian setup. For an Arquillian setup, I'm going to use a test framework. The test framework I'm going to use is going to be JUnit. You can use JUnit or TestNG or any, if you wanted to use any add-ons, you can install them as well. With that JUnit, I can choose perhaps which test framework version, if you wanted to choose a specific version of JUnit. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to go into the container adapter, and I'm going to say that my container is Wildfly Remote. As I mentioned, Wildfly Remote allows me to control my server. My Wildfly server is currently up, so I just leave it like that. I also need to say which version of my Wildfly I'm going to be using. So this is container adapter version, and my version is 10.1.0.final. And that's pretty much what all I need to do in order to set that up. Let me just double check. Yep, that should be fine. So I'm going to set that up. That's going to add everything I need, add to my settings. The next thing we can do is create a class file, which is actually going to be our test. So I'm going to write Arquillian. Is it create test or test create? Create test. So let's create our test. And in order to create the test, I need to point them to my targets. So I'll say targets. Targets. I hit tab completion, get to my targets. And in this case, what I'm actually going to want to target is the protons bean. So I'm going to go to view and then protons bean. That's what I want to do. Let me see if there's anything else I need to do. Let's enable JPA. Yeah, that sounds good. And that's the only thing I need to do. So that creates our test. Let's go back over to Eclipse here, and let's refresh our test here. And all of a sudden, we have an application here. Our class file here. Now, in this test, it looks actually kind of reasonably similar to our JUnit. All we need to do is we need a run with annotation here to say this is actually going to be pushed with Arquillian. We can use injection because we're running in a container. We don't need to mock up anything. So we'll just use injection to push in our protons bean. We need a deployment, and this is going to be shrink wrap. This is effectively creating our war archive that we need to then deploy onto Wildfly. The only thing I'm going to do here is I'm just going to add the protons entity class. Let's also import that in. And then we have our test. In this case, all we're doing here is just making sure that our class, our protons bean, is actually going to be injected in. So that's we can leave it at that. That's pretty much all I need to do. So the next thing I need to do, let's actually check our POM. That's an important one, because when we actually enable Arquillian in our POM, what we're going to see, in fact, let's just have a look at our POM, because since we've been doing that, we've actually got a whole bunch of dependencies which have been added to our POM, including JUnit, including Arquillian, including the JSF, including some CDI, including some servlet, validation API, some Hibernate. So every time we're doing this, Forge is keeping my environment up to date, keeping my POM up to date. But since we've added Arquillian, what we've got is this Arquillian Wildfly plugin profile. And I'm going to grab this, and this is what we're going to use in order to actually invoke it. So to actually run now, I'm going to hit build, I'm going to run test, but we're going to run with a profile, and this profile is going to be the Arquillian Wildfly remote profile. So I hit go, it's going to be doing our build, we're going to run our tests. We're running our tests. That's the deploy. Oh, wow, that was quick. That's the deploy. We then see testers run. Then we do our undeployment. And then we just say, yes, your test ran. So we're running it with every build. We're using a container, so we don't need to mock anything up. And it's running very, very similar to a unit test. We're seeing the results in the build as if it was a unit test. So that's Arquillian. You can just write Arquillian and run that with your build. The next thing I want to show you is Swarm. Everyone loves microservices. It seems to be the buzzword. So now how can we use Swarm within something like JBoss Forge? So I'm going to come out to the users. SJ Maple, let's go back into my downloads directory. And what I want to do is, here I've got a file called... called Dev Nexus Swarm. I thought I changed that. Actually, I think I did. But one of the things that Forge allows you to do, and one of the big powers of Forge, is that you can actually execute a script. You can execute a script from within Forge if you chose to, just using the run command, or from outside if you actually run JBoss Forge with a dash E followed by the file name. It'll actually load up Forge, run your script, and then drop your instance of Forge down. So it allows you to then generate applications with large scripts. And if you wanted to just subtly change your application, you just subtly change the scripts and kick it off. So it's very, very easy to automate what you're doing to create your scripts. So here all we're doing is we're creating a new project. We're calling it SwarmCERN. We're going to create a new endpoint called SwarmEndpoint, which just has a simple get method, and then we're going to call WildflySwarmSetup. And you'll notice WildflySwarmSetup has no arguments at all, because all that does is just add a dependency to our POM. And with that dependency, we then generate a fat jar. And the fat jar allows us to bundle WildFly into our application, and then we can run it as a standalone application. So if I was to run this, I think I've got it here. Run swarm, did I call it run swarm sum.fsh? So if I run this now, we create our new project, we create our new endpoints, and WildFly Swarm is now set up. So if I was to look at the POM, let's just go from here, users, SJ Maple, downloads, and I'll call it it was Swarm CERN, I think. No. Doesn't like tab completion right now. Okay. Swarm CERN, there we go. And in here, if I was to cat my POM XML, we just have this dependency here, which allows us to, which basically will create our fat jar for us. If I was to then build that, this is going to build, and I'll jump into another browser here, another terminal here. I'll go into swarm CERN, and I'll go into the target. Now that's built. If I look in here, we have our swarm CERN war and our swarm CERN jar. If I was to actually look at the size of that, you're going to notice it's going to be pretty big. Now, when we talk about JBoss is one of those nice application servers that, while it can be pretty big, under the covers it uses something called JBoss modules. And JBoss modules componentizes the application server so that when you throw it into a fat jar using something like Swarm, you only put in the modules or the fragments that you actually require. So, if I was to just Java minus jar this, what I'm first going to do actually is I'm going to go into, where am I? I'm in download. So I'm going to go into it was Voxed, wasn't it? So go to Voxed there and shut down. Oh, I'm not in Forge anymore. Okay. Come on, Forge, don't let me down. There we go. So, I'm in VoxCERN already. So I just say shut down. So let's shut down JBoss Forge. WildFly. There we go. Okay, now I can very, very simply just Java minus jar my swarm dash swarm jar here. And this is going to, you'll see in just a second, these are the, where are they? These are all the modules that we're actually going to be using. If I actually go, so it's all ready. So if I go to my browser again, let's go localhost 8080, and what was it, swarm, actually let's have a look at our REST endpoint. I think it's actually just going to be REST swarm, oops, Swarm or something like that. And we get some text. This method do get invoked. If I was actually go in and have a look at the code. Back over here, if I was to come out of this and go into my swarm.cern. If I was to go into my source, main, Java, do an ls here, and actually just edit swarm endpoint, we'll see our get method. We'll see our get method here, and all we're doing is just returning method do get invoked. And of course, using Swarm, you can start up these as many times as you want, and you can have your microservices environment very, very simply and straightforwardly. So that's Swarm. Any questions about Forge or anything that we've talked about so far? All good. Okay. So the next thing I'm gonna briefly talk about is Spring Boot. As I mentioned, Josh pretty much covered Spring Boot. But for those who haven't seen Spring Boot or looked at Spring Boot, I went straight to the Spring Boot site to have a look at how they describe Spring Boot. And these are the words they use. So it takes an opinionated view of building production-ready Spring applications. So it's an opinionated view. Spring Boot gives you an opinionated view because what it does is it uses convention over configuration. It decides how Spring configuration should by default look, and it will provide you with that easy view. So all you need to do is pull in a startup kind of dependency, and you'll have all your defaults set for you. It's production ready because if we use an actuator add-on to Spring Boot, an actuator dependency, we can get a whole load of metrics. We can check some health, and we'll have a look at that as well. It says we favor convention over configuration, designed to get you up and running as quickly as possible, because essentially it's going to bundle our Tomcat for us. It's going to run our app as simply as an application, so you can Java minus Jara or Java your main method. So let's actually go to start.spring.io. Maybe you saw this with Josh's session as well, where basically here we can generate whatever we want, Maven or Gradle project. We can choose which version of Spring Boot you want to use, and you can add whatever dependencies you want. So let's add a web, H2, let's go for some Spring security, let's go for an actuator, and the actuator is effectively what will provide us with that production-ready information. What else can we add? One of the other things we can do is switch to the full version, which will provide you with the full list of information, or full list of add-ons that you can choose. But I think we're pretty much done with this. I don't think there's anything else. Or maybe some JPA. Let's add JPA as well. But yeah, once you've done that, you can effectively give your artifact a name. We can just call it demo if we want here. Generate a project, and it will create me a zip file, hopefully. There it is, demo.zip here. If I open this up, you'll see just our usual POM environment. I can open this directly in Eclipse. So let's go out of this. Let's open, let's import. Hang on, do I import into the import? Oh, shit, that's export. Import. New Maven, existing Maven project. In this project, I'm going to import my demo. There it is. And what we're going to do is in here, we get started with our demo application. You can see our demo application here. You can also see that it provides you with some tests, so you can add some tests as well. Just to show you this is actually working, we have our Spring Boot annotation, which allows Spring to understand this is going to be running as a Spring Boot application. And all we do is just effectively you can run this as a regular Java application. Let's create an application endpoint. We'll call it hello. In this, all we're going to do is just return hello. They're going to make this add a request mapping. We'll call that hello. And also, we need a REST controller here. I'm going to import everything. Whoops, import everything. Save that, and now to what's wrong with you? Oh, I spelt it wrong. Okay, there we go. And now we can actually just run this straight away as a Java application. And when we run this, it's effectively, it looks like it's actually enabled JRebel as well. We can have a play with that a little bit later. But what it's actually doing is it's embedded Tomcat directly into our demo application. And now we'll be able to see, hopefully, when this finishes, endpoint, oh yes, I enabled Spring Security. Tomcat failed to start, and that is because our swarm is still running, so we can run that again. And because obviously I've enabled Spring Security, I need to log in when I first access this, so I'll grab that as well. So there is our password, so let me just grab that while I'm here. Copy that. And the other thing that you see is all these endpoints that have been registered. And these are the endpoints. This is why Spring Boot says it's production ready. As a result of having these, well, there are two reasons. First of all, Spring Boot is completely supported in production, so you can just deploy your boot applications into your live environments. But also it provides you with a bunch of these, I'm not sure if Josh showed you these as well, a bunch of these endpoints where you can actually see the health of your application, the metrics, how many times you're hitting your application, and so forth. So it looks like Spring is up. Spring Boot is up, so if I was to come here and go to my local host and I actually added hello as my endpoint. Yes, I need to use Spring Security, and there we have hello. So our endpoint is actually working. It also had JRebel, actually. Let me quickly show you what JRebel does. JRebel is enabled. So that was actually pre-enabled on a previous project that I had called Demo. But one of the things that JRebel allows you to do is make changes to your application code while you are actually in your runtime environment. So rather than keep restarting, I can write code and I can test it in production in my runtime instantly. So, for example, if I was to change this, let me just do a couple of things. Oops. Let's do this one instead. It's a much better song. Too slow. There we go. Good, I can turn that off. If only I could type as fast as Josh, that would have been spot on and nailed as Lionel was singing it. But yeah, obviously with JRebel, you can make those changes and see it live in your runtime, so you don't have to do the restarts. So we're production ready, are we? So let's have a look at that. If I type in metrics, we see some metrics. We can see, for example, at the bottom, hello has been called once. We can also see, in fact, normally if I refresh this, we can also see that metrics has been called once. It's actually been called twice now, but it's kind of a little bit like that kind of cat in a box thing. If I was to call hello a couple more. Not you. Let's go here. Localhost call hello. Oh, I don't know the Adele song, so I'll just type Adele. Hello, Adele. Okay, so now if I come back here, we can see third from the bottom, hello.name. There we go, that's been called twice. So this is just our usual hello without that kind of path variable on. So yeah, we can see some of that. If I was to type in env, this could be sometimes quite useful to see our environment variables as well. If I was to type in, what else can I type in? Let's type in mappings. And that shows us actually everything that is actually available to us at our runtime. We can also choose health if I wanted to. We can see what's happening. You can see that the status is up. You can see how much disk space is remaining. You can see our database there, what's being stored, and things like that. So the production style view actually provides you with endpoints that you can use to actually monitor your environment as well. So how are we doing for time? Pretty well. We have 4 minutes left for questions. So does anyone have any questions on... one other thing I will actually show you as well is that from within Forge, if I was to come out of here and just say... Well, actually, I could just say Project New if I wanted to. If I go Project New, let's just hit Return. Project name is Spring Boot App. We can go, yeah, final name, whatever. Here now we can choose Spring Boot if we choose. We can choose Maven as well, that's fine. And here we can actually just select however many dependencies we want. So I can type 106, 105, and you'll see them checking off here. As soon as I hit return, then we have our Spring Boot application. One of the differences between kind of Spring Boot, which kind of does a lot of auto generation, as well as Forge, is that Forge you can use on existing projects or new projects as well. So I can actually go into an existing project and add some entities, do whatever I want, and view the application there. Whereas Spring Boot is typically something that you would do from scratch rather than migrate a Spring app into Spring Boot and so forth. That's everything I had to show you. I hope you enjoyed the session. Any questions?
If you have questions, please turn on the microphone right in front of you. Thank you.
Is it difficult to create new templates?
New add-ons? Because JBoss Forge is open source, you can see all the add-on code already in GitHub. So in order to actually get started, you can pretty much do it very, very simply. It's not too hard at all. It's not too hard. And the JBoss Forge guys will help you. There's George or Lincoln Baxter and people like that. They'll help you create them if you run into any problems. The JBoss Forge Twitter handle is also very, very responsive. For example, I had a problem just recently whereby I couldn't actually... when I was running Arquillian, my tests were literally not being run, even if I put skip tests false on everywhere in my POM. And I just pinged them. Within 30 minutes, they'd replied with a kind of new build that I could use. So they have very good support, and it's open source, so you can contribute yourself as well. No worries. Any other questions? Yes.
About JBoss Forge, okay. I've used, for example, Spring Roo, which is kind of similar in a concept. And the thing with Spring Roo, at least, it was that it was great for prototyping, but we weren't able to really use it because automatic generated code is kind of difficult to maintain at the later states of project. Is it the same generally in Forge?
Yeah. I would say when you actually generate, when you're doing anything where you're generated code, as soon as you go into that kind of environment, yeah, it's gonna be tough and tricky. One of the nice things about the differences between kind of Spring Roo, for example, and Forge is that because Forge is so open, it's entirely pluggable to any application type you want. But yeah, that's typically the a problem for anything that you do with generated code, really. Okay, any other questions? Awesome. Well, thank you very much for your
attention.
It's an absolute pleasure to be here.